Hey, what's up, everybody? I just want to say thank you so much for joining us here at Revo Church today. My name is Charles, and I'm the lead pastor here at Revo Church. And on behalf of myself, my wife, and our whole Revo crew, we want to say thank you so much for tuning in and hanging out with us today. If this is your first time, I just want to ask you a little favor. Right there on your screen, there's a connect link. If you can just click that link, fill out your information, so that we can get it, and we're not going to show up to your house. We're not going to do anything crazy. We just want to know who you are. We want to send you a little thank you email. We want to send you a little thank you text message just to say thanks so much for joining us today. You know, guys, if you call Revo Church your home, you know, this is our opportunity and our time to give through our tithes and our offering. Right before we go into worship, you know, we consider this worship. And, you know, through this time and through this season, I just want to say personally, just kind of look right there in the camera, and I want to say as your pastor, thank you so much for continuing to give. You know, a lot of times in these crises, the church giving kind of normally goes down, but we as a new church, I can honestly say that we have kind of stayed the same, which is a miracle in itself. And so I just want to say thank you, guys. You don't know how much that means to me. You don't know how much that means to our city. It's because of your generosity and because of your giving. Actually, yesterday, on Saturday, we were able to partner up with other churches and literally feed thousands of people here in Marion County. And that's because of you. And so I just want to ask you, hey, listen, if you can't tithe full 10%, I want to ask you to do something. You know, just because we can't do everything doesn't mean that we can't do something. And so maybe that something for you is $20 or $30 or $50, whatever that is. I just want to encourage you to do something because it's your giving that's helping others. And I believe with the generosity of your heart, you know, God blesses a cheerful giver. So I don't want you to tithe 10% and be an old mean Scrooge. Man, if you can generously with a cheerful heart give $20 or give $30, hey, let that be a start for you. And we have two simple ways that you can do that. You can use your smartphone and you can text 77296. And in the message bar, you can type Revo space and the amount that you would want to give. So kind of like Revo space 20, Revo space 30, whatever that is. And you can also give online at revochurchfl.com. Guys, this is going to be an amazing year. I can feel it. I know it. I know that we've all gone through some craziness, but you have continued to stay faithful. And so I just want to say thank you again for that. Well, I hope you're ready for an amazing day. This is going to be an amazing time of worship, and this is also going to be an amazing opportunity for us, myself included, to hear from a great friend of ours, Phil and Lucinda Dooley from Hillsong Church, South Africa. And so I hope you have your notepads ready. I hope you're ready to lean in and really receive everything that it is that God wants to have for us today. Come on, let's worship Him and let's get ready for an amazing word.
Oh, is yet to come. The cross before me, my hope on things above. And in you, Jesus, the best is yet to come. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. Yeah, yeah. Ooh, oh, we worship you, Jesus. Ooh, oh, oh. Oh, I know breakthrough is coming.
It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore.
Sing it with us.
And now my shame is gone. I stand amazed in your love undeniable. Your grace goes on, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Whoa. Whoa. You're the name above. You're the name above all names. Whoa.
Well, hey, everybody at Revo Church. I mean, we're from Australia, you'd say Revo Church. We're so glad to be with you guys. Revelation, revolution, revival, it is all happening in Florida with you guys. Pastor Charles and Mariah, you guys are amazing. I mean, you've just launched church and suddenly a global pandemic and it hasn't stopped you. You are still advancing and it's a privilege for us together to bring the word to you guys today. Pray it is going to absolutely bless your hearts.
Yeah, huge, really huge thank you to you guys for having us today. And we really are praying that the word is going to impact you and enlarge you and strengthen you. And we're believing that you can take it into your week and really go from strength to strength. So thank you so much. Absolutely love you guys and we pray you're blessed today.
We believe the best is yet to come from Revo Church. So love you guys. Thanks for being with us, or thanks you for allowing us to be with you and sending all our love to Charles and Mariah and the entire team. God bless you guys. Hey, well, we're so excited to be bringing the word today together. And we're going to be looking at Numbers 13. We're going to be considering the story of the 12 spies, the promised land, and how we got to fight for the promises that God has for our lives and build faith into our hearts. So I'm excited about it. Why don't we pray?
Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, we pray tonight, Father, that this message, Lord, that you would use it to impact the hearts and the minds of every single listener tonight, Father. Take this message, Father, and accomplish everything that you've intended. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said together.
Amen.
Amen. Be blessed by the word.
Yes. Well, I'm going to start. So high five. And then my wife is going to speak into the second part of this message. So here's the thing. In Numbers 13, we read about Moses, okay? Moses is the guy who's in charge of the people of Israel. And Moses is all about leading the people into the promised land. He has led them out of Egypt, where they were under oppression, where life was tough and it was difficult. And he and Aaron had to keep going to Pharaoh. Finally, Pharaoh lets them go. And they end up going through, you know, you may know the story, through the Red Sea. They go through this, and as they're going through it, God miraculously opens it up. The Egyptians with Pharaoh are fired up. They don't want them to leave, and so they go through the sea. As they go through it, the waves close, the water closes in on them, and Moses and God's people escape. Now, you would think they'd go straight into the promise, but they don't. God takes them on a journey through the wilderness. And this is what happens in our lives as well. Often we come out of how we were living, out of the oppression, out of the, you know, the overwhelming power of sin. And we know God has this promise for our lives. We know that there is more He has for us, but there's this journey that He takes us through. God is all about dealing with us in the journey, on the way to the promise. Often we live our lives where we just want to go to the destination, don't we? We put in our Google Maps, or we use our phone, and we're like, okay, here's where I want to go. Get me there the fastest. Get me there without traffic. Get me there without whatever might come in my way. Show me where the speed cameras are. I just want to get there as quick as I can. But God is as interested in the journey as He is in where He is taking us to. And we've got to learn this. And that requires patience, that requires courage, that requires us opening our hearts to God. I love this statement, let the journey make you so the destination doesn't break you. There are times in life where we want to get to the destination, but we've got to grow into the person who can handle the promise that God has for us. Well, let's fast forward. Do you like that? Fast forward to the point now where Moses and God's people, the Israelites, are ready to head into the promised land. They are right there. It is before them. They have wandered through the wilderness for 40 years. But while they've been in the wilderness, God's looked after them. They've had a cloud to follow in the day. Then there was fire in the cloud at night, and they'd follow that, and God would take them where He would, and they learned to be obedient to Him. And God provided manna from heaven every day. God gave them food, so they didn't have to look after themselves really at all. They just followed the cloud to go where they needed to go, and they got manna to eat, and they were fine. Now it's time to move into the promise. Now is time to move into this next phase, this exciting adventure that God has for them. And Moses says in Numbers 13, let's get 12 together, representing the tribes of Israel, let's go and check the promised land out. So they do that. Here's the issue. When they come back, we read about a whole lot of them being, in fact, 10 of them being freaked out, overwhelmed. Yes, they say it's wonderful, but they also say, man, these people are giants. There is no way we can defeat them. In fact, this is what it says about this promised land and about where God's taking them into it. We read these spies saying, we went into the land which you sent out, and yes, it does flow with milk and honey, and it's here is its fruit. But you got to be careful when there's a but. Why is the but there? What's the but all about? But the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. We saw the descendants of Anak there, and they go on and on and on and talk about all the reasons why they can't enter the promised land. They would rather get the backpack, put it on, turn around, and go back into the wilderness. Go back where it's comfortable. I've got a nice lounge over there. Maybe I'll just sit there. Maybe I'll just enjoy the comfort of the lounge. Maybe I'll just stay in a place where I don't have to fight, because this enemy looks big. This enemy looks difficult. This is a challenge. And as much as the promise looks great, the milk and the honey and all that's there looks amazing, there's giants. I don't want to deal with giants. I mean, how many times have we seen something that we go, man, God is stirring that in my heart, but it's difficult. It's hard. That's going to require a fight. I don't know if I have that kind of fight in me. In fact, there's four things I want us to consider as we look at this today. And then my wife's going to come. Lucinda's going to come. She's going to finish this message for us. Four things for us to consider that I've seen. Okay, two of these spies are Joshua and Caleb. They enter into the promise. The other 10 we never hear of. Here's the first thought. Don't get so comfortable in the wilderness that you forget how to fight for the promise. I've found that in life, we can get so comfortable where we are that we lose sight or we get so caught up in the complacency of where we are that we don't have the fight to pursue the promise. You know, right now, we're in a season where life is different than it ever has been. And maybe we got comfortable in one way of living, but God is saying, no, it's time to fight for something new. There is a new promise. There's something new in the way we're doing church and the way we're relating and connecting with people. And it's a fight because it's uncomfortable. It's not what I've ever done before. And it's causing me to have to step out of where I feel at ease. That's what always happens whenever you are going to head into the promise. It's going to be uncomfortable. It's not going to be easy. But let's be people who understand, like Joshua and Caleb, that the promise is going to require fight. The issue is these guys had forgotten how to fight. They'd been in the wilderness for so long. God had provided them just with what they needed that they'd lost the will and the desire to fight. Let's never be like that. You know what? I saw something that blessed me so much this week. We've got some amazing staff and team here in South Africa. And one of them is a guy named Williams. Williams is on our cleaning team. So Williams helps look after our buildings. He's on our maintenance team, and he and the whole team do a brilliant job. Well, right now, as is happening all around the world, we're not really using our buildings. So there's not a lot of maintenance, a lot of cleaning, a lot of work for Williams to do. But what's Williams doing? Williams isn't just going, oh, well, nothing to do. You know, that's just the way it is. Williams is helping our Hillsong Africa Foundation team. And I think we've got some images of Williams going out, helping feed people, helping provide for people. It's uncomfortable for him because he's never done that before. He's never been part of this team. He's never been out serving like that. He's always been in the building. And now he's going out into some communities and being a blessing to those people in a new and different ways. I love that. And we can all do that. If we get too comfortable and just stay how we are, we're never going to step into the new and into the promises that God has for us. Second thought is the wilderness is not your final destination. Right now, you may be in a bit of a wilderness. Maybe God's taken you out of something, but you know there is a promise for you. Well, the wilderness isn't your final destination. You're not designed to stay there. So don't get too comfortable there. It's just for a season while God works on you. But while he's working on you, keep in your heart that understanding that there is more of the promise of God for your life. Maybe now is a great time for you to write down what that promise looks like, to remind yourself that there is more that God has for you, and not to get so comfortable in the season you're in that you don't have any fight to keep pursuing what God wants to take you into. Number three, every promise requires a fight. Every promise of God is going to require something of you to stand up, to speak with faith, to see with faith, to have the courage to keep moving forward. In John 16, 33, Jesus said this. He said, I've told you these things so that in me you have peace. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. Jesus is saying the reality is in the world we live in, there is trouble, there is difficulty. Whether it be a virus that has caused a global shutdown and challenges with economies and health challenges and all kinds of different issues, or whether it's something else, there are always challenges in this world. Jesus never said, I'm going to take you out of this world into some kind of promise where there's no problems. He said, no, I've given you the ability. I've overcome the world. When you look to me, when you learn from me, when you recognize the Spirit of God inside of you, you have the capacity to say, I'm going to keep fighting forward because every promise has a fight. Let's be people who understand this and are committed to it, like Joshua and like Caleb. And number four, fear or faith are both a choice. They're both a choice. Sadly, 10 of these spies chose fear. They saw the promise. And I find it so fascinating that all 12, Joshua, Caleb, the other 10, they all grew up in the same environment. They'd all been on this wilderness journey. They'd all listened to Moses. They'd all seen God provide for them, getting them out of the oppression of Egypt. They'd experienced all of it. They saw the same thing. But two of them saw with faith and 10 of them saw with fear. Faith and fear are a choice. And I want to encourage you today to make the choice of faith in your life. See with faith the possibilities, the promises that God has for you. I pray today that you are encouraged to know that God has so much more promises for you and for your life. When Lucinda and I moved to South Africa, I know she's going to speak a bit more about that. She's going to speak about Caleb and his journey to the fulfillment of the promise. When we moved to South Africa, we had a choice, fear or faith. There are a whole lot of things that could have been fearful. People speaking negative words. Why would you go to South Africa? There's crime. There's this. There's that. It's comfortable where you are. We love Australia. We love Sydney. And the only reason we were moving was because God was stirring a promise in our heart. But we had to make a choice. Was it going to be fear that stopped that promise, or was it going to be faith that God was with us, taking us into this new adventure? 12 years on, we couldn't be more grateful that we had the courage to take that step of faith, and to see what God has done is incredible. Blows my mind. So many amazing people who are part of our church family in South Africa, and so much more that God has for all of us. When we make the decision, you know what? I'm going to step forward in faith, not let the fear overwhelm me. We can see God do all kinds of extraordinary things in and through us and see us stepping forward into the promise. I'm going to invite my wife to come and join me right now, and she's going to speak into the second part of this message.
Well, church, how amazing was that? I absolutely love those points, and I want to encourage you to take them into your week and let them really be a blessing to you. Okay, now I'm going to pick the story up in Numbers chapter 13, and it says this, but Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Let's go at once and take the land, he said. We can certainly conquer it. Can I read that one more time? Because it's so awesome. But Caleb tried to quiet the people as they stood before Moses. Let's go at once and take the land, he said. We can certainly conquer it. I love this verse. And there's two things happening in this verse. Number one thing that's happening is Caleb had to silence the wrong voices. And the number two thing that's happening is Caleb had to make the right choices. And do you know, I think Caleb was onto something here. I think he realized if he doesn't silence the wrong voices, he won't be able to step into everything that God has for him. And do you know what? Exactly the same for you and I. I believe if we can resolve to listen to the right voices, we will be able to step into all that God has got for us. I remember for me, the right voices started at a young age. I was 14 years of age, and I gave my life to Jesus. And I got totally fired up and passionate about Jesus. And I thought, I'm going to go to school and I'm going to tell all my friends about Jesus. The only problem is when I went to school and I told them about Jesus, I soon discovered that they were not quite as passionate about Jesus as I was. And I used to wear glasses then. And my school friends used to say, Lucinda, do you see Jesus in your glasses? And they would tell me that I had gone absolutely crazy. And I soon realized at a young age that I was going to have to make a decision what voices I was going to listen to. Then I remember growing up in church. What a privilege to grow up in our church. And I remember I got to an age where I thought, I don't want to just come to church anymore. I actually want to serve in church. I want to get involved. And so I remember saying, hey, what can I do? And I would get there early and I would leave late and I would just serve and I would do whatever it took. And I remember well-meaning people I grew up with, they would say to me, Lucinda, you're crazy. They'd tell me again, I'm going crazy. I am crazy. And they'd say, you know, you're too fanatical. They tell me I'm too fanatical. And you know what they'd say to me? They'd say, you're never going to meet a husband if you go this crazy. And do you know, again, I had to decide what voices I was going to listen to. And then I remember people close to me, people in my circle, they'd say to me, Lucinda, I took a job at church. And they'd say, Lucinda, can't you see that the church is using you? I thought that was amazing because I had prayed all my life that God would use me one day. And now he was using me. And they're telling me, can't you see that God is using you? You're crazy. And I remember, again, having to make a decision what voices I was going to listen to. And you know what? It doesn't stop there. Then it got announced one day that we were going to move to Africa. And I'll never forget this. People, well-meaning people, they didn't mean harm by it. But they would find me and they'd say, Lucinda, have you thought about this? You know, if you moved to Africa, you could get shot. I mean, you could get killed in Africa. And I thought that was hilarious. And, you know, they're saying Africa is a dangerous place. And again, I had to realize what voices I was going to listen to. And then it doesn't stop there. Then we moved to Africa. And I'll never forget this. We moved over here and we were looking for where we would pioneer Hillsong Church in Africa. And we really wanted to be like a light on the top of a hill. And so we found this beautiful building in the heart of the city called the CTICC. And we thought, how awesome would this be? Imagine if we could have church there. And, you know, we didn't know many people here, but we did know one businessman. And Phil thought, I'll go and make an appointment with him and I'll chat to him about it. The sad thing is that this businessman, he told the businessman what we were thinking. And this businessman looked back at Phil and said, Phil, can I ask you a question? What are you trying to prove by going here? And it was almost like an arrow in the heart. And Phil came home and he told me about this. And I was like, the minute he told me, I became even more indignant. I was going to prove this man wrong because I thought, man, we've got to make a decision again, what voices that we are going to listen to. And you know what, church? I have realized in my life thus far that the voices you listen to are going to determine what you step into in your future. So I want to ask you a question today. What voices are you listening to? And I want to encourage our church today to listen to the right voices. You know, the other day I put the news on and I try to watch the news sometimes, not all the time, but on this day I thought, I want to catch up with all that's going on. And I listened to the news and I walked away from it. I listened for about half an hour. Then I walked away and I immediately felt overwhelmed and I felt like discouraged. And I was deflated and I realized that I'd listened to a whole lot of bad news. I'd listened to a whole lot of bad voices. And I want to encourage our church. It's very good to be informed. It's good to listen to the news. It's good to be up to speed with what's happening in the world. But you've got to get a good balance there. And I want to encourage our church today. Don't keep downloading from the world, but start downloading from the Word. And if we can download from the Word more than we do from the world, I believe you're going to be able to listen to the right voice and you're going to be able to step into everything that God has for you. You know, the best voice of all to listen to, of course, is the voice of God. And in a beautiful scripture in the Bible, it says this, the Word of God giveth life. How awesome is that, church? The Word of God gives you life. It brings you life. It feeds you. It lifts you. It encourages you. It births something new in you. And can I encourage our church at this time in history, at this time in the world, to keep downloading from this book, the Word of God? Because every time you stay in this Word, it is giving you life. Then I love what it says in Hebrews 4 and verse 12. It says this, the Word of God is alive and it is active and it is sharper than a two-edged sword. How awesome is that, church? The Word of God is alive and it is active. You should just shout that out wherever you are today, because that is good news. Every time you open this book, it's alive. Every time you open it, it's active. It's doing something in you. It is not a dead book. It is an alive book. And I want to encourage you, keep downloading from this book. It is alive. It is active. And it is sharp. It will speak to you and it will encourage you. Download from the Word, not from the world. And you know, I love when the disciples come to Jesus and they say, teach us how to pray. And Jesus says this, he says, this is how you should pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And do you know what, church? I believe for every one of you, God has got daily bread. He wants to speak to you every single day. He wants to give you life every single day. He wants to be active every single day. He wants to be alive in your life every single day. Give us today our daily bread. And can I encourage you, church, with all my heart, keep downloading from the Word and not from the world. Because Caleb, that's what Caleb did. He actually had to silence the wrong voices and listen to the right voices. And the second thing I want to speak to us about today is the second thing that Caleb had to do is Caleb actually had to make the right choices, voices and choices. Caleb had to make the right choices. In verse 28, he says this, let us go at once and conquer the land. We can certainly do it. I absolutely love his confidence. I love his faith. I love that everybody around him was saying, we can't conquer it. We can't do it. But Caleb had this resolve. He had this certainty in his heart. And he said, we can do it. And you know, if there's one word that I'm hearing at the moment, church, the word that I hear is there's so much uncertainty. And do you know, I just want to remind your heart and remind your mind today, although things around us are uncertain, do you know what today? God is absolutely certain. His promises are yes and amen. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And do know what? If things are feeling shaky around you, uncertain around you, keep pulling yourself back like Caleb did. Put your certainty in God because he is absolutely sure of what is going on. And you know, Caleb had the ability to do this. Caleb could see past the natural into the supernatural. Caleb could see past the problem and he could see the possibility. And Caleb could see past the obstacle and he could see the opportunity. How awesome is that, church? And I want to ask you, can you do that? Can you see past the natural to the supernatural, the problem to the possibility, the obstacle to the opportunity? Because I believe Caleb actually had the ability to make the right choices because he could do that. And in Luke 18, it says this, Luke 18, verse 27, it says, what is impossible with man is possible with God. And if that is the truth, if there's a problem, I love what John Maxwell once said. John Maxwell said this, every miracle begins with a problem. And if you have a problem today, you are the perfect candidate for a miracle. And in Isaiah 55, it says this awesome scripture. It says, my thoughts are nothing like your thoughts. And my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. How amazing is that, church? God's thoughts are way higher than our thoughts, way higher. God's ways are way beyond anything we could imagine. And if that is the truth, if that is the truth, church, which it is, I believe then we can actually have the ability to see past the natural to the supernatural, past the problem to the possibility, and past the obstacle to the opportunity. It all depends what you see. Now, I have a glass here of water. Do you see this glass half empty or do you see this glass half full? Do you know what? It all depends on what you see. I've got a picture that I'm going to put up on the screen. Now, there's two things you can see. There's an old lady and a young lady. Who sees the old lady? Who sees the young lady? Do you know what? It all depends what you see. And church, I want to encourage your heart today. If we are going to make the right choices, You've got to pull yourself back in and you've got to say, okay, I'm going to put my certainty, I'm going to download from the Word, I'm going to put my faith and certainty in God, because if it's impossible with man, it's possible with Him. I'm going to look past the natural and see the supernatural. I'm going to look past the problem and see the possibility, and past the obstacle and see the opportunity. And I believe, church, if we can actually silence the wrong voices and make the right choices, I believe we're going to step into everything that Jesus has for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So I really pray that you are blessed by the Word today. I pray that you take that into your week and let it encourage you. And Phil is going to come up. Pastor Phil is going to come up and pray with a group of people here today. God bless.
Fantastic. Hey, thank you so much to my beautiful wife. I pray that that message has really spoken to your heart. Hey, you've got to listen to the right voices if you're going to make the right choices. And Caleb did that. Caleb and Joshua, and they ended up in the promise, the promises of God. He has them for all of us, not just for those we read about in the Bible, but for us today in our lives. And I just want to encourage you today to take hold of that. Maybe things have got a little bit comfortable. Maybe, you know, you've kind of got a little bit relaxed. Maybe you've lost the fight. I want to remind you today that the Holy Spirit of God in you gives you the strength to fight for what God has for your future. So, hey, let me pray for you. Wherever you are, you can bow your heads, close your eyes, and let's pray. Father, I just thank you for every person who's heard this message today. I pray, Lord, that we would be people who would truly see with faith. Lord, not let fear grip us, but see with faith the possibilities, the potential that you have for our lives, the promises that you have for our futures. Lord, may that stir within us, that faith that Caleb, that Joshua had, may it be in us too, we pray. And I also want to take a moment to pray for people here who say, you know what, Phil, I've been away from God. I haven't been living for Him, but I want to make that choice today. I don't want to let fear rule me. I want to live for God. I want to live for the future that He has for me. Well, you know what? That begins with a simple prayer. You know, a prayer that says, Jesus, Son of God, forgive me, give me a brand new start. I believe that's exactly what He'll do. It's a prayer that says, God, I don't want to do this life on my own, but I want to know You. I want to know Your plan that You have for me. And so I'd love to pray that prayer right now. And maybe for you, this is a recommitment back to God, or maybe it's the first time that you've made a decision like this to say yes to God. But come on, if that's you, would you pray this with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank You for Your Son, Jesus. Thank You for everything He's done for me. And right now, I open my heart, my life, everything I am, and I give it to You. I thank You from this moment, I am forgiven. I'm a child of God. I'm leaving the past behind, and I'm walking forward into my future with Jesus as my Lord, as my Savior, as my friend.